By country every quarter to identify which organizations actually have capacity that information and an algorithm, organizations are sorted, and that information is presented on how to help lists that will be provided to larger media, larger corporate and foundation donors, and individuals in the public, so that they can make more informed decisions about how to help. It incentivizes transparency because groups won't show up on those lists if they don't share their data, and they don't have the capacity to deliver services right away. And we're trying to basically prevent money from taking what we call the seven-stop layover that takes 2 years. So people donate money to a larger organization that's not located in the disaster zone. That organization then regrants that money or some of that money in time on their own pace to organizations more local to the disaster, if we're lucky. And so we find that after disasters, very little of what's actually intended to be donated to people that have been affected actually reach those people because of these unnecessary layers. And so if we can help people go more directly, then we can improve the effectiveness of disaster relief dollars. So we started this build 17 months ago, and been very fortunate to work with the folks at Prebug, Kevin, John, Jesse, Reed, Bill, Mark, and really everyone there has been awesome to work with. This has been mostly volunteer-fueled effort, and we're recruiting volunteers to help us get us not only launch, but post MVP features. And so I welcome you to join the team. Feel free to email us and let us know if you're interested in helping. But really, it's been great working with the folks at Prebug, and I really appreciate the opportunity to speak with y'all today. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so that was Ben, who we've been working with, and when I first met him, actually, it was a couple of us at lunch. Just hearing him talk about kind of a lot of the things that aren't there. Donating to organizations. This website is going to do a lot of good to make sure that funds are going to the places that you think they're going to. Ben kind of touched on this a little bit, but just to reiterate, this platform collects and analyzes location specific data of pre and post disaster from local, state, and national organizations. And specifically, it is the first independent data-driven resource to display this information. And it covers things like budget, types of services provided, number of staff on the ground, history, affiliations that certain organizations have, and the total funds raised during that particular response. And again, relief oftentimes isn't getting to those who need it the most. So donations, you know, sit in the bank, they don't get their time, they may be reallocated into different areas of these larger organizations. And what struck me was that a lot of people are kind of donating in the dark. When you hear of a major disaster, sometimes we just go to, you know, some of these major organizations that we have come to mind first. And we don't always know where our funds are going because a lot of these organizations don't make that information public. And Smart Response is going to flip that around and going to work with organizations that are willing to make their information public and make it easier for donors to connect with those organizations. And you, as a donor, can know that I want to donate my funds to a specific disaster, maybe a specific region, or just an organization. So that's kind of a quick overview of the product as a whole. We'll talk a little bit now about some of the technical things we've been working on next. So we are kind of opening this up to developers if they want to get involved. So hopefully some of this stuff will get you guys excited. But the application is on Angular 4. We're using Angular CLI. And it's backed on the Node server, and we're currently running on Heroku and have continuous integration set up with Travis. And then the server is written in Java as well. So when we first took this on, this project was kind of a mono repo. Everything was in one GitHub repo. The front end is a subdirectory along with everything else. A lot of the build commands were integrated with, you know, setting up the Java backend locally, and the setup steps were, in the magnitude of 10 or 12 steps, and there's a whole thread of how do I get this thing bootstrapped as a new developer. And there was no continuous integration setup, no code coverage, no unit tests, no style guide. It was kind of like the Wild West, and there's, I think, somewhere around 60 or 70 developers that work on this at one time or another, across the world. So there's a quite diverse style of code within this repo. So recently, one of the first things we did is split the front end and web app out into its own repo. This kind of gave us that separation of concerns. So as a new developer coming on, you really don't have to worry about the Angular side of things and front end side of things and test steps. You know, we brought those down just to a few npm commands and Python. It also gave us the ability to kind of make deployments a lot easier. We're just focusing on the front end instead of front end back end deployment all at once. And I think this has led to quicker cycles in development. We can now focus front end developers on one code base and the other. Makes testing easier, continuous integration a lot quicker. We've also, like I said, we set things up on Heroku with Travis. So before there was no unit test running on pull requests, there was no style guide checking, things were just being checked in left and right. Not too long ago, I took on the task of fixing all the style linting problems, and that took me quite a while and had to never touch every single file. So doing it after the fact was not advised, but we got it done, we got it straightened out. We've also, since it is a distributed team, we have tried to lock down certain things to keep the styles and the tests and all that thing in check. So we implemented things like git hooks to make sure that people aren't checking in things kind of outside of our agreed upon style. One really interesting thing I like about this project is it kind of has an open source feel. So it's not open source in the sense that you can just find repos and start committing. You do kind of need to reach out to bin, which I'll have that information here at the end. But there's a large community of people working on this project, and they span nearly every time zone. So it's interesting to work with people from different areas of the world, kind of see how they think, how they interact, how they write code. And that's really been really interesting to me as part of this project. Different styles and tools. And there's also a big opportunity for skill sets, from big architectural design problems to minor CSS to UX UI testing. There's a lot of opportunity for people to get involved. Some of the integrations we made since joining the project, one of them was App Pay, and this is kind of a key part to this to Smart Response. That it connects donors directly with organizations without middlemen. So there are some competitors in the space, but most of them are kind of involved in that transfer of funds between the donor makes a donation to a disaster organization. So this allows organizations to process the donations themselves without any added costs. And Salesforce is another integration we're working on right now, which is kind of in progress, but with all this data being public and open, Salesforce is going to allow us to provide better analytics and data for donors. So going forward, we're still plenty of things to do. We're getting very close to wrapping up MVP and launching, but there's still tasks from new features to fixing current features. If you decide to join the project, even just reviewing PRs can be helpful. So again, we are writing this application in Angular 4, so a lot of this stuff is new to a lot of people. But even just reviewing a PR can be helpful in addition to writing code. And then as a company, post MVP, kind of our next big overtaking or plan of action is to implement a Redux state management pattern. So if you have or have worked on that, that's a big opportunity to get some experience with that as well. So again, like Ben said, this is a kind of a call to action. If you do have any interest in donating your time to this cause, I think it's a worthwhile venture, not only to help other people, other donors, but to also gain some experience. This email here is a great way to get a hold of Ben and let him know that's something you want to do, and I'm happy to hand this information out afterwards. And also, these are kind of some of the skill sets that we're kind of looking for right now. So obviously, I can go for, if you're kind of a back-end Java person, we'll be out there as well, testing, DevOps, down to social media, copywriting, business development, things like that. So that is kind of in my speech. I'm happy to answer any questions. We have Al in the back corner there, who's with us from Breba. He's our business development person, so if you'd like to talk about any work you need done, or if you're looking for a job, we can talk about that as well, or disaster kind of release. Thank you.
Yeah. What kind of data are you getting from my organization?
The data is really, you know, down to like where the funds are going, where they're accepting the funds, how much of those funds are actually going to the places that they earmark them for. So the kind of pre and the post surveys are kind of tying those two things together. There's also an independent survey that we're reaching out to on the ground to help verify that. So within Smart Response, you have the ability to kind of red flag certain data aspects. So when the site moderator gets involved and make sure that, like, hey, what you're saying is actually true. Ben can probably speak a little bit more to kind of the back end data and how that's tying into from a business standpoint. But the goal is to, if you were a donor, you can say, I want to donate money to, let's say, the Boulder floods, right, in that specific area. And I want to know if I'm a reasonable certainty that that's where my funds are going. And not just I'm donating to, you know, maybe your big organization, and maybe it goes to, you know, their general organization building cost or that sort of stuff.
Great, thanks for coming.